Now let's try to understand band structure of calcium, titanium, strontium, titanium. First of all, what do we think about three times the generated lowest band? You see that it is three times the generated. Because in an arc going, it's not split. Then you move. Then you move. What do you think? What is a three times degenerated lowest band? What is practically non-degenerated next band? And why is this huge valence band? It consists of many levels. Again, the idea is the same. But now, what you have in crystal? You have valence electrons of oxygen, but now there are three oxygens. And these three oxygens gave you three by three, nine sub-bands. And in gamma point, where three degenerate levels, you see three, three, and three. Nine P states. This is again P band of oxygen, but now the structure of crystal is such that it consists three oxygens. So this is P band of oxygen. This is S band of oxygen, but now you have three oxygens. And each was non-degenerate in magnesium oxide, but now they are split. But in any case, you have three. You see that in this direction, you see that it's split on three sub-bands. So this is S-band oxygen, this is P-band oxygen. And what is this? This is S-band of titanium. Strontium. And titanium bands are in conduction. So the idea is the same, but the band structure is more complicated because this crystal is ternary oxide, and you have several oxygens. And what is important, that when you make band structure calculations, of course, it will be, if you have correctly working program, then of course it will be reproduced in degeneracy correctly. And of course, this connection with states of atoms will be the same, independent of plane waves or LCAO, but you will have oxygen band, oxygen S band, titanium, excuse me, strontium S band, and titanium D band. So, when you have more atoms and more complicated system, then you will have more complicated band structure. On this picture, I simply gave you the same band structure of calcium, strontium, titanium, but only showed 2p and titanium 3D bands, so you can see in more detail the degeneracy. Again, I repeat, you see, here there are given irreducible representations in gamma point. This is cubic crystal. Therefore, from point of view of cubic group, these are three degenerated levels. This U means that in this crystal you have inversion, therefore they are odd in relative inversion. Nine degenerates three by three. And then depending on the direction, it is split. In any case, this is oxygen to P band. And for titanium, you have one titanium, so the 3D, there are five functions, and again, the splitting is different. So I wanted to show you that the subbands are defined by the relative positions of valence electron levels in the atoms forming crystal. But when they form crystal, they are distorted, and then you can have different crossings, and then in many cases you cannot say so simply as in this case about the bands, also bands connection with atoms. So I want to say that I tried to explain you a connection with of electron states in crystals with energy bands which you find in your in papers where you which you are reading, trying to understand what is the system. So I can suggest this is another story, just about formulas. But before I begin this story, I want to say that if you have concrete crystal, if you are experimentalist, if you investigate optical properties or magnetical properties or something else, you need at first to know from literature, from database, you need to know the space group. And you need to know also from database positions of atoms occupied in this space group, like of positions. Then, if there are some published some band structure calculations, then you can, reading the papers, analyze the nature of subbands and the band gap, which is the result of calculations. If there are no calculations at all, then ask theoreticians in your institute to make these calculations. But in any case, you need to know the space group in direct letters. And now there are some points which I'll demonstrate on the side. Dima, please help me. I need site build bound. This simply broken down. Now I shall show you one thing which looks like strange and ununderstandable for usual user Bilbao server. Okay. Now let's see. We finished with electron energy bands of tritanium, strontium, titanium, oxygen 3. It was simple cubic lattice, space group number 221. On this side, you can find Wyckoff sets. And if you put the number of space group, you will see the positions which I already, excuse me, this is direct lattice. In direct lattice, you have, okay, in direct lattice, I already showed this. This is Wyckoff positions in direct lattice. Now I want to demonstrate you the connection between Wyckoff positions in direct lattice with Brillouin zone symmetry points in reciprocal lattice. But at first, in strontium titanium, if we put here titanium in 0, 0, 0 and strontium in this B, then we need to put oxygen in D so that the distance will be half of cube edge. So this is indirect lattice. A, B, D. Now let's see what gives us for the same group this side. This is important to understand band structure. You see here the coordinates of points in the reciprocal lattice, which I already gave you, gamma, r, m, x. And then directions, delta, lambda, and so on. K vector description. And here on right, you see the number of points which we already discussed for simple cubic letters. 1 gamma, 1 r, 3m, 3x, all is okay. But, one but. When you take space group, you also can see Brillouin zone picture here. I speak about this for those who are not working with perovskite, but with working some crystal which you are interested in. Then you always can see on this side Brillouin zone, if you know space group. And this is Brillouin zone, which we already have seen. And what is this part of Brillouin zone? This is so-called irreducible part of Brillouin zone. This part consists of one point from any star. If you take R point or gamma point, then they are in this part and all the rest are equivalent. But if you take some general point, it's also, there is some general point, then you will have 48 general points. And one of them is in this irreducible part of Brillouin zone. How you can find the size of the irreducible part? It is 1 divided by the order of point group. If you have cubic group, there are 48 durations. This is 1 divided by 48. If you have some other lower point symmetry group, then you will have a larger irreducible part. This is more or less clear, but what is strange, and I'll try to explain it, that for space group of magnesium oxide, again we see Brillouin zone. Now you know this, I showed you. But what you see here? You see here that K vector types of space group, Brillouin zone, and you see that it is the same Brillouin zone for several space groups, 4 space groups from 225, 26, 27, 28. And I need to explain why it is the same. This is 1. And 2, it's written reciprocal space group 299. This confuses physicists and, of course, chemists who don't know this. And I'll explain it. The situation is clear from my preceding explanation that in reciprocal space, only point part of the space group element works. This R, which I showed by labeled by R, only R acts on K vector. But in all these 4 space groups, point part is the same, OH. Let's see these groups in the list of space groups. It's very important that you understand it because it's not so easy to understand. Let's see the whole list of space groups and let's see what is different. This is symorphic group with face-centered cubic lattice and point group OH. This is crystallographic label of point group OH. This is first group, first cubic group with face-centered cubic lattice. And the rest ones, 6, 7, and 8, are space groups which are non-symorphic. Here you have glide plane, this C. Here you have also glide plane, different. This is space group of diamond, which I already explained. This is the next space group. And why all these 4 different groups, and in direct lattice they are different, and wave position sets are different, why they have the same Brillouin zone? Because each crystalline class, each crystalline structure is characterized by point symmetry, or so-called crystal class. not lattice class, but crystal class. And in this case, all these four space groups refer to OH points. In direct lattice, they have different symmetry elements, different sets of vibration positions. But in reciprocal lattice, only OH point group operations connect different symmetry positions of cave vectors. And therefore, they all have the same Brillouin zone. Is it clear? Cleon. Savage. Again, I'll repeat it. It's important to understand, because when you read your paper with some calculation of some crystal, and you know that this is not 225 but 227, you will see the same set of K points, and you will try to understand. Of course, band structure will be different, maybe because you have different atoms and different number of subbands. But the Brillouin zone, the symbols of K vectors, will be the same. Because in reciprocal lattice, only point part of a group is important, independently on the translation part. This translation part is here only pure lattice translation. Here, some translations are improper, and here and here. But they are important for direct lattice, but not for reciprocal lattice. This is important to understand. Okay, so let's return to the relation. And last, maybe 20-25 minutes, I'll try to explain you Fuhlmann's calculations. But in this case, I decided to return to molecule to explain you what is the Fuhlmann symmetry for this tetragonal molecule, iodine fluorine 5, which we already considered. Very simple table. I took x, y, and z coordinates and wrote out 8 point symmetry operations. Identity, rotation around z-axis on 90 degrees, c4z, rotation on 180, c2z, rotation on 270, then reflection in plane orthogonal to xy, in plane orthogonal to y plane, and two diagonal planes. These are all symmetry operations. We already discussed them when analyzed the symmetry of this molecule. So, iodine ionism z-axis, one of 5 fluorine atoms is on z-axis, and the rest ones in the plane. What I did, I took x, y, z, and tried to understand what happens with them when I apply to x, y, z, to 3 displacement components, all the symmetry operations, identity. Nothing changes. Rotate by 90 degrees, for example, in this direction. It is clear that x goes to y. X goes to y. And y goes to minus x. But z doesn't change because I rotate around the axis along z. Is it clear the idea that by this way I simply looked how transform x, y, and z when all the symmetry operations of group act on these 3 coordinates. And what I see? I see that this z coordinate, this one, doesn't change because all the operations are made or rotations around all the axes or reflections in planes which contain this excess. So this is 1, 1, 1, 1. But what happens here? For each translator, for each operation, I have written matrix which applied to XY gives me this one. Identity matrix applied to XY gives me XY. This matrix applied to column Y minus 6 gives me, you understand the principle or no? I simply wrote the matrices 2 by 2 which realize this transformation. Nothing. Is it clear? Let's see what happens.
You said something. I didn't hear what it was.
X minus Y. Y minus X. Matrix. This line on column X, Y. 0 by X minus Y. Minus Y. So I receive that X and Y coordinates transform over two-dimensional representation, which is labeled by E, and Z coordinate transform around identity representation, because that coordinate doesn't change. By this way, I tried to explain you, especially for those who have never heard lectures on group theory, that this 4V point group can be analyzed not only from point of view of irreducible representations, but also from point of view of X, Y, and Z coordinates transformation. And for Fulman calculations, it's important. For infrared spectra, it's important to include only those representations for infrared, which are connected with X, Y, and Z. But for Raman spectra, selection rules require quadratic components. So, if we consider some molecule with this C4V symmetry, we can say that in infrared spectra, transformations A1 and E will be active. But, and I demonstrated you this. What these figures mean? These figures mean so-called character of reducible representation. This is the sum of diagonal elements. 2, 0, minus 2, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. This is sum of diagonal elements of corresponding matrix. This is dimension 2, and all the rest are one dimension. But in infrared A1 and E, in let's see which are active in Raman. A1, because this is Z squared. B1, X squared minus Y squared. B2 and E in a whole 5 as dielectrons. This table is also possible for analysis of electron states transformation, because X, Y, Z is P function, and these squared coordinates combinations are D functions. And what do you think about S functions? To which representation are they correspond? They are not given here at all. S functions, what do you think? S functions are spherical symmetric. Therefore, all the operations which are applied to them do not change them. And therefore, they always transform over the identity representation. So, in books, you can find such tables, and they are very useful to use for Fonon analysis. So, when you know the point group of the crystal, you open this point group and see table which gives you connection between irreducible representations of this point group and combinations of X, Y, Z coordinates. Linear combinations are active in infrared, quadratic functions and combinations in Raman. Is it clear? Where is our site? Here. So on site, you can find this, you can find this information for other, for all the point groups which you can meet in crystals. Representations and applications, point. I already tried to explain you the connection between Schoenflies and crystallography, crystallographic symbols of point groups. This is our C4V. This is table Z, X, and Y, which I already explained how they transform. But you can find all what you need for any crystal, because for any crystal you have some or other point symmetry. For example, if you have cubic crystal, then you open this window, and in infrared spectra will be active this three-dimensional representation, and in Raman spectra will be active this T2G, three functions, and these two easy. So when you have crystal, then you know space group, then you know point group of the crystal with the with notification that when you are arranged in the point group, you need to exclude from single of space group those operations which are glide planes refractions or screw axis rotations. And then from point group you can find what you want, which representations are active in infrared and Raman spectrum. This is for point groups. For space groups it's more difficult, because in this case you need to add k-vector. And fortunately, for crystalline solids, Raman and infrared spectra of first order, it's enough gamma point. Only gamma point and brilliant zone. But in gamma point of brilliant zone, you always have point symmetry of crystal itself. Let's make one experiment. Please give me some point group of crystal which you are interested in, but not cubic, not C4V. Sasha, have you some point group? Nina? Which? TH. This one. No, this is TD. This one.
Yes.
Open this table and immediately see which coordinates are active in infrared and which are active in Raman. In infrared, which one? TU. And in Raman? Infrared TU, and in Raman? EG. Two of them, and TG. But you can ask me, why this EG with one and two? Because they are two, but these are details of group theory. In any case, this is two times degenerated, but this degeneration appears because they are complex conjugated representation. But these are details which are not necessary. So when you know space group, you immediately find point group, and then you can say which irreducible representations are active in Raman or infrared spectrum. This is very nice, but this is not enough, because you know the whole structure, not only the point group of the crystal. Let's return to molecule. We have one A for iodine, for one iodine, one A for one fluorine, and then we know from this table that A1 and E are active in fraction in plane. So at first, we need to open local point group. This is CS, consisting of identity and reflection. And it has only two representations, A prime and A two times prime. And then we need to understand which irreducible representations of whole group we receive from those given by one of four Fluorine atoms. This is so-called induction process. And you can find in different books, including my books, you can find such tables where at first, for any point group, you have symmetry of x, y, z, or their square combinations, which irreducible representations are realized, but it is not enough. If you have in your molecule or crystal like positions occupied by several atoms, as in this case, four Fluorine atoms, each of them has x, y, z, and there are four. So in a whole, it's 3 by 4, x, y, z, by 4 atoms. So you have 12 in the whole displacements. And then you need to use table for the whole group C4V, analyzing what happens here from reflection. And one detail, you can put them in position B or C, and it depends, it will be this or this, but these are details. In any case, when I use this table, I receive what I receive. I receive A1 four times, A2 one time, B1 two times, B2 one time. I simply have these two and all those which are received from the x, y, z of these four fluorines. But why here I have two and here I have no two? Because they are not equivalent. Two of them are equivalent and four of them are equivalent, but each has x, y, z coordinates. And if your plane, for example, is orthogonal to x axis, then you have coordinates in this plane transforming over one reducible presentation and two other in the second. So by this way, you can find the total symmetry of fluorines in your molecule or crystal at gamma point. Of course, you needn't do such calculations at all, because now on the side, very nice thing, it is given in some program. And you can find it if you understand how to do it. It is one point. I'll demonstrate it if I'll have more 10 minutes. But what I want to say, that nowadays good programs do it automatically. And I asked Sergei Piskunov to calculate me for this lecture, this molecule, iodine fluoride 5. And he did it. And then he made calculations of electronic structure and found equilibrium structure. Because what is important, that fluorines are traditionally calculated in so-called harmonic approximation. What it means? It means that at first you need to find equilibrium structure of crystal or molecule, doesn't matter. And only when you find it, only for this equilibrium structure, you can make calculations of fluorines. Harmonic approximation means that you have only quadratic points in the row over displacements of atoms, which give you fluorines. If you take into account third power and so on, they go out from harmonic. But it's very difficult calculations. I will not go there. And then using his equilibrium geometry, I made myself calculations of fluorines. And now you see that clever code crystal did it automatically. It gave symmetry elements of C4V group. This is C to Z. These are two rotations on 90 and 270 degrees. These are two reflections in one set of two planes and in second. And then it gave even those irreducible representations of quantum. And then automatically calculated the result, which I demonstrated to you how I can receive it. And it gives you the same what I want. And then it printed frequencies, calculated. And what is important, that in this case, seeing this point group theory, you can find frequencies which are active in Raman, which are active in infrared or in both. ER are active, Raman are active, E inactive. So, for example, let's see. Inactive in Raman, this one, and this one. Inactive in infrared, but they are active in Raman. So, using the sight, and I'll demonstrate this is for some spot, for we can do it maybe for perovskite. You can calculate frequencies in crystalline solids, gamma point of brilliant zone, and this program gives you the activity of different frequencies in infrared or Raman spectra. For example, in this case, this is given here. So you see that, of course, it's nice to know the basis of this finding, but good programs can do it automatically. You need only to understand what they do. You might want to go out from this and return to sight. Escape. Yeah, okay. And now. Now I'll try to speak how to find symmetry of forms for perovskite. And by this example I plan to finish my lectures. What we need to know? We need to know. Open please perovskite. No, no, this picture. upstairs where we have vacuum positions. Let's return to first lecture. When I showed you perovskite structure, and when I showed you Wyckoff positions of all atoms in primitive human cell. Now I shall try to find, using Bilbao server, symmetry of phonons, and by this way define their activity in infrared or Raman spectra, using the information on this left screen. I'll use left screen for the first of two possible descriptions of strontium titanate, and on the right screen I'll try to explain you how we can define Fowler symmetry for all of these atoms. First of all, one strontium, three displacements, x, y, z. One titanium, three, x, y, z. Three oxygens, each one has three, so we have three by three, nine, and then 12, and then 15. Number of atoms multiplied by three, x, y, 15. So in a whole, we need to find symmetry of 15 displacements. Three of them will reflect the possibility of move the whole cell as a whole, not the vibrations in the crystal. And they have to transform over x, y, z representation of the whole point. So formally optical phonons, we will have how much? 15 minus 3, 12. And now what we do, need to do, this is not trivial. In our book with Professor Smirnov, which was published in Springer in two editions, we guessed that site symmetry approach, allowing you to move from local subgroup to the whole group, is very useful for phonon calculations. Then, first edition was sold out. Second edition appears, and after this, I went to Bilbao and explained them what means site symmetry applications. And then the clever Spanish students included this in server. And now we can find immediately the symmetry of phonons connected with titanium, strontium, and oxygen. First, what we need, we give space group of our crystal. Second, what we need to give point of Brillouin zone, but as I already told, for AM and infrared, it's enough to give gamma point. Now you understand that this is 0, 0, 0. No, it asks some label, it have no Greek Greek letters, so I'll write simply, doesn't matter, G. And it asks me, select Vaikov positions. Oops. We put in A titanium. I put here and move. Select representative. But A position has one representative. Show. And this at this point is the most important. It gives us all the symmetry operations of local symmetry group of titanium, which is cubic. Therefore, it gives us 48, but you need these details. You need to move to this table to see you are interested in phonons. So you need to find the irreducible representation of this local group, which is realized by x, y, z. This is well already. So T1. So titanium gives us T1U. Next is unpleasant, because in solid state physics, these are labels from Schoenflies, but these are labels from solid state. This G means gamma, but this 4 minus means E1U. But inside, when you are interested in more detail for your crystal, you can find an explanation. So it T1U, and it is only gamma 4 minus. So this is clear with titanium. Now let's see what happens with strontium. Strontium also is 1 in Vaikov position. And again has cubic local group. And again in this cubic local group is T1U. And again we have this. But you see what happens. T1U, gamma 4 minus. So, gamma 4 minus is given both by titanium and strontium. More interesting situation is with oxygen. Oxygen in this situation occupies the Vaikov position. There are 3 points. You can choose any of them. And when they prepared this program, and I tried to check it, I checked if the result depends on the choice. The result cannot depend on the choice because they are equivalent. And I received different results for phonon symmetry. And I informed them that your program has some errors. and they analyzed and found the rest. So when you have equivalent three oxygens, independently of which of these three positions you will choose, the result of course cannot depend on this. So now the situation is different. Three oxygens, each of them has point group only of 16 durations, D4H, and this is this group, and we need to take this EU for XY and this ATU for Z. ATU for Z and EU for XY. And what we have now? We have now ATU gamma 4 minus and AU gamma 4 minus gamma 5 minus. Thus, we received the whole symmetry of formants in this crystal. And I think Nina agrees with me that there are no Raman spectra in this crystal, because all these representations are U-type, negative, and they are not active in Raman. Is it correct? And this is given by group theory. So, applying this side symmetry approach, if you read, you can read some papers, the references are given on the site itself, you can read them, and if you are interested, analyze. Of course, you cannot calculate by this way the frequencies themselves, but you can analyze which types of frequencies and how many of them are active in Raman or infrared. They give on site different tutorials. You can analyze samples, and they have references on different articles. So you can see this. This is very useful site. But from discussions with some people during these days, I understood that some people seem that they can find structure of crystals on this site. No, there are no structure of real crystals. There is only group theory in different aspects. The real structures can be found in crystallographic open database. When you give the chemical elements, and it finds you the structure. By this way, I thank you very much for attention, and I finish.
Thank you.
Could you recommend any literature except your book?
I think my book is the best. No, I joke. Literature in which field?
In group theory application, respect to the solid state.
There are many groups, many books. I tried to write book in such a way that to explain difference between molecules and crystalline solids. You can find books, Petrashen and Trifonov, but this is translated to English. It was published in Russian, but it is translated. Application of group theory in quantum mechanics. One. Many other books. Maybe it was my mistake, Anatoly, that I have gave the list of books. You simply use browser, ask space group theory, and it will give you long list.
Oh, of course, but here is a question about your recommendations.
I think that from recent books, you can find in my books connection between quantum chemistry with atomic states and so on, and symmetry. Because in traditional books from solid state physics, you don't know this connection. If you are interested in solid state itself, in group theory, then this is other books. But if you are interested in this connection, then I recommend, not because I want to say that my books are the best, because from my experience I know that this connection is important. Because people make calculations, people want to analyze the results, and for this they need to know something from solid state groups and from point.
Okay, other questions?
As Germans say, Alles klar.
Alles klar.
Natürlich.
Paldies par lekcijām, bija ļoti interesanti, es domāju, un vien jau kāds nekādu nav kaut kas no skaidrs, var vērsties tiešo, uzdot jautājumus, iespējams, ka mēs varbūt redzēsim jūs vēl pēc kādu laiku.
Nu, es noteikti atbraukšu 18. Gadā uz to FMNT 2018.
Jā, jā.
Kādā mēnesī tā būs?
Pašlaik domāju, iespējams, ka oktobrī, vai nav.
Bet tas būtu noteikti Rīgā, jā? Jūs dabūsiet daudz naudas, tāpēc, ka mums 100 gadu Latvijas neatkarība. Es tā ticu, varbūt.
Nu,
tas bija mana pirmā pieredze tādā lietā, un angļu valodā. Nedomājot, ka tas ir tik viegli. Runāt angļu valodā, kad es neesmu native speaker angļu valodā. Man pat latviski kādreiz ir vieglāk runāt nekā angliski, bet latviešu valodā es nezinu, kā ir band structure. Nu, nezinu, kā tas būs latviešu. Kā tas būs?
Zonu
struktūra.
Tā būs?
Zonu
structure. Zonu structure. Struktūra. Nu? But in English it's not so easy, because it's not native language, and I always need to find the words. Sometimes I forget them, and I try to find the equivalent. It's not so easy. So those of you who graduated some special English language schools or have been long time abroad may say, oh, his English is... But what can I do?
Labi, paldies,
paldies. Paldies jūs.